I would like to take this opportunity to express my deep and sincere gratitude to the Lanson Foundation and its chair, Dr. Edgar Chang, for the generous and unwavering support for the faculty over these years. Apart from financial support, Dr. Chang has actually rolled up his sleeves to be a shepherd for the development of the Center for Bioethics. So please join me in giving Dr. Chang a round of applause for his tremendous contributions. My special thanks also go to Professor Jonathan Glover, a well-renowned expert on bioethics, for coming over to illuminate us on two concepts of dignity. I would also like to thank Professor Campbell, who will be sharing with us reflections on Professor Glover's lecture as a discussion. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm now turning over to Professor Lee, Interim Director of the Center for Bioethics, to kind of introduce to you Professor Glover and his lecture. Professor Lee, please.
It is a great pleasure to welcome all of you to the inaugural Lanson Lecture in Bioethics. It is a real treat to have Professor Glover deliver the first Lanson Lecture. In fact, I cannot think of anyone better qualified than him to deliver this lecture. Professor Glover is a leading philosopher who specializes in practical ethics, of which bioethics is a subfield. He has been chair professor of ethics at King's College London for the past 18 years. Prior to taking up his professorship at King's, he had already been a famous world-class philosopher teaching at Oxford University for some 30 years. He studied philosophy and psychology at Corpus Christi College, Oxford, and he then obtained his BPhil degree in philosophy at Oxford, and then began teaching at New College, Oxford. He has written 7 books. His first book, Responsibility, was a major contribution to the literature on free will and responsibility. His second book, Causing Death and Saving Life, is now a classic. It was the first book-length philosophical treatment on issues of practical ethics. The topic treated range from moral theory to abortion, suicide, euthanasia, the death penalty, and the ethics of war. What Sort of People Should There Be, published in 1984, was the first philosophical book ever written on the ethics of eugenic choices, and in its second half, the first book on what's now called neuroethics. Choosing Children, Gene, Disability and Design, descended from his inaugural lecture. Inaugural Euhero Lecture in Practical Ethics, delivered at Oxford University. Besides practical ethics, Professor Glover is an expert in the philosophy of mind, psychology, and psychiatry. He has written books entitled I, the Philosophy and Psychology of Personal Identity. His recent book is Alien Landscape, Interpreting Disordered Minds. As a reviewer says, this book should become a classic in the study of philosophy and psychiatry. His widely acclaimed book, Humanity, is a moral history of the 20th century. In addition, he chaired a European Commission working party on assisted reproduction, and the Glover Report was published in 1989. His works have been translated into various languages, including French, Finnish, Italian, Japanese, Korean, Norwegian, and Spanish. Finally, I also like to express my thanks to Dr. Edgar Chang for giving the CHK Center for Bioethics strong support, both financially and beyond. Without his support, the Lanson Lecture Series would not be possible. Let's welcome Professor Jonathan Glover to deliver the first Lanson Lecture.
I feel greatly honored to be giving the first Lanson lecture. When Professor Hon Lam Lee contacted me, I thought it would be very nice to come to Hong Kong again. I was slightly intimidated by the thought of giving the first inaugural lecture in this series, but I spent most of my life somehow overcoming the feelings of modesty that would be really appropriate and somehow convincing myself that, well, perhaps I won't be a total fraud in doing it. But I'd like to say first that I really appreciate the invitation to give this lecture, and I would like to thank Dr. Edgar Cheng, who's done so much, obviously, for the faculty and for the Bioethics Center, and indeed, who has made these lectures possible. I'm enormously grateful. And I'd also like to thank Professor Hon Lam Lee. I remember him. I feel embarrassed about when he reads out my list of books, I feel embarrassed how old they make me sound. First one published in 1970. Most of your parents weren't born then, probably. But I remember Hon as a graduate student in Oxford, a lively and interesting graduate student, now a distinguished professor. And I've also this week learnt one extra thing about him, which is that he is an enormously supportive and generous host. He's given vast amounts of his time this week to taking my wife, Vivette, and me to interesting places and showing us and telling us about things. We've had an absolutely wonderful time, and Hon, I'm most grateful. Thank you. Now, my topic, respect for dignity, I want to talk about, I've just noticed that in quite a lot of literature about bioethics, the word dignity is used, and half of me thinks that that's a really good thing, because respect for human dignity is obviously a very important and desirable thing. On the other hand, the other half of me thinks that since nobody is actually against respecting human dignity, there's a danger of falling into platitude and waffle if one just says, I believe in respect for dignity. I want to make a big distinction between two kinds of respect for dignity. One is not humiliating people. We all know how horrifying it is to see someone being humiliated. If you see, and not very long ago, my wife and I were in a restaurant in London, and we were looking out of the window, and there were one or two people sitting at a table outside. And a beggar came up and asked them for money. I think they should have given money. Many of you may not agree with that. There are different views on the ethics of what you do with beggars, but I incline to think that it's so much worse not to give money to someone who does need it than it is to give money to somebody who's a cheat. But he was treated abominably, and they didn't just politely say no. They contemptuously waved him away. And I was horrified by this. It's a humiliating experience for anyone to be treated like that. We also are horrified when someone is excluded from somewhere because of their ethnicity or their religion. Again, a humiliating experience. Or we find it terrible if someone is laughed at and ridiculed because of their disability. So I think we all understand the idea of you mustn't disrespect people's dignity by humiliating them. But there's another not entirely different, but very different idea of respect for dignity. And that is respect for a person's moral standing. This is something which is originally developed by the great 18th century German philosopher Immanuel Kant. And I mean, he was interested in many things about ethics. He was a philosopher of genius. though it has to be said, not a philosopher who wrote the most lucid prose. But he was one of the things he was interested in is, what is it that gives human beings the special status? Why are we concerned about human beings and not about mosquitoes or coffee cups or all sorts of other things we might be? And he argued that a central idea in ethics is that we have rights and moral claims, and that this comes from the status we have. And respect for dignity, he thought, was quite a lot to do with respect for people's moral standing, for respect for whatever it is that we human beings have that other beings don't. Now, I'll say a few words first about respect for dignity as not humiliating people. This rules out, for fairly obviously, a lot of policies. For instance, the early humiliation of Jews by the Nazi regime, where they were forced to wear a yellow star, forced to change their names, excluded from certain professions. We can think of other examples. The old regime in South Africa, the old racist regime, had humiliating pass laws and similar exclusions. Various aspects of British colonial policy in Africa, for instance. I won't say anything against British colonial policy in Hong Kong. I'm sure it must have been absolutely wonderful. But certainly in Africa sometimes, my father worked as a colonial official in Africa. They often refer to adult Africans working for them as boys when they were, you know, often in their 50s. There are various things which showed a lack of respect and tended to be humiliating. Also, I think it's fair to say that certain aspects of the Chinese Cultural Revolution involved rather horrifying humiliations, where, for instance, sometimes teachers would have to endure humiliating public denunciations by children kowtowing on their knees and wearing dunces' caps and having to make groveling public self-criticism. This kind of respect also rules out the horrendous public floggings in Saudi Arabia, for instance. And it also rules out the shackling and blindfolding of prisoners in Guantanamo. That's, of course, I've been talking about official policies that involve humiliation of people. But, of course, there's other unofficial humiliation, which is very widespread often in a society and can be very bad too. I mentioned turning away a beggar with contempt. Other things include, for instance, the stigmatization of people who are gay or who have psychiatric problems. And I think no elaborate theory is necessary to say why this sort of humiliation is a terrible thing. It's a form of cruelty, quite unnecessary, and something to avoid at all times. One of the other things which I think is not so often noticed is that sometimes these humiliating acts or policies actually weaken the inhibition against the major atrocities that sometimes take place. I mean, to take an example from British colonialism, taking a thing in the British Raj in India, General Dyer, in the town of Amritsar, after there'd been a riot in which a British officer had been killed, General Dyer imposed what he called a crawling order, that any Indians, many of them lived in that street, any Indians going down that street weren't allowed to walk, they had to crawl. And that's a clear instance of using public punishment by way of humiliation. And what I think is interesting and deeply disturbing, apart from the cruelty of the humiliation in itself, is that a little while after that, there was a demonstration, huge demonstration, against the policy in Amritsar, and British troops shot a very large number of the demonstrators. And my own belief is that, while they might have done it anyway, if you start by humiliating people, that removes one of the barriers to treating them with abominable cruelty and massacre. To take another example, because I think, you see, people who humiliate other people, other groups, are themselves changed in ways that make atrocities easier. And one very clear, catastrophic example, when the Nazi German troops entered the town, the Polish town of Bialystok, they drove Jews out of the town by beating and shooting. And what they then did was they set light to the beards of religious Jews, and their dignity was removed by that, and also when they asked for protection, they were urinated on. And at the end of this process, the Jews were all locked up in the synagogue, and then they set fire to the synagogue, burning them all to death. Now, I think that there's good reason to think that the humiliation in that kind of case plays a causal role in making it easier for the people who carry out the atrocities to do so. Years after the Second World War, Franz Stangl, the commandant of the Nazi extermination camp in Treblinka, was asked by a journalist why, if they were going to kill them anyway, what was the point of all the humiliation and the cruelty? And he replied, to condition those who actually had to carry out the policies to make it possible for them to do what they did. Now, that's, I don't need to make a very elaborate case against that kind of humiliation. Let me now turn to the other sense of respect for dignity, showing the respect appropriate to someone's moral standing. As I said, talking in introducing the topic, we have moral standing, which gives us rights and moral claims on people. And Kant asked the question, what is it about human beings that gives us this special status? And his answer, roughly, was rational moral agency. He thought that human beings are autonomous, rational, and capable of morality, and that these are the things that give us the moral standing that mean we deserve respect. Now, there are all sorts of questions we might ask about this, but one interesting thing is that Kant does particularly use the word dignity. He says that things in the world have either a price or a dignity. Many things, if you have a car, it has a price, and it's replaceable. If somebody steals your car, you can buy another, assuming you've got the money or the insurance will pay. If someone steals your car, you can buy another, it's replaceable. But if somebody kills your child, they are not replaceable in that same way. And he says, everything has either a price or a dignity. What has a price can be replaced, but a rational moral agent doesn't merely have a relative worth, but has an inner worth, that is, a dignity. Now, what he means by dignity isn't obviously just exactly the same as not being humiliated. He means roughly that this dignity is, we have the property of being rational moral agents who are, as a result, have moral claims, moral rights. One obvious question is, what happens if people are immoral? I'm sure no one in this room has ever been in any way immoral, but suppose we had, what would we do? Would we lose our moral standing? Or do we just keep our moral standing, our moral rights as human beings, despite the fact we sometimes behave badly? And Kant considers somebody who tells a potential murderer a lie. Kant believes that a lie is an absolutely forbidden act. And he takes the case, which might seem to tell against his view. The person comes in with a weapon, says, where is so-and-so, obviously intending to kill that person. I think quite a lot of us, certainly I would feel that if you can't call in the police to prevent the thing, you just want to play for time, tell a lie, tell the person to go somewhere else, and then phone the police and tell them where the murderer has gone. That's what I'd feel was the right thing to do. Who knows what I'd actually do, because I go into a blind panic if somebody comes rushing into my room with a weapon. But I think that Kant has this rather strange view. He says that someone who tells even a potential murderer a lie, even to save someone's life, he says that that person violates the dignity of humanity in his own person, and so becomes a mere deceptive appearance of a human being who has even less worth than a mere thing. Now, many of Kant's ideas about moral standing are deservedly influential. But I think when we admire some of Kant's ideas, it's worth remembering this utterly appalling view that anyone who saves somebody else's life by telling a lie simply has lost all status as a human being and is actually even less worth than a mere thing. So you can, that seems to suggest that a liar has no rights at all, no moral claims. Stub your cigarette out on his face or whatever, and you won't be doing anything wrong because he's less worth than an ashtray. Now, what I want to focus on here is what can be meant by saying this, that telling a lie violates the dignity of humanity. This is an abstraction. It's not rooted in any concern, it seems to me, any concern for what matters in human terms, either to the potential murder victim or the person who gives protection by lying. And what I'm hoping to do is draw a contrast throughout this lecture between approaches to ethics which are rooted in human sympathy, human intuitive understanding of what matters to people, and approaches to ethics which are abstract and legalistic in producing some definition, some abstract principle about the worth of humanity or whatever. And I want to suggest that the approach, which I don't like, the more Kantian approach, is still very much alive in some parts of bioethics, and ideally it should be given up. Now, I want to turn now to respect for dignity in bioethics. And there, the idea of dignity as moral standing, not the thing about humiliation, but the thing about respect for the status, the moral status a person has. This is often cited, this kind of respect for dignity, is often cited in arguments against things like assisted suicide and embryo research. So I want to talk a bit about these two cases. First, assisted suicide. When people argue about whether it's all right for either legislation to allow assisted suicide or for a person to help someone in a desperate state in a terminal illness, help someone to kill themselves, interestingly, the appeals to dignity are used on both sides. And I'll start with a case which brings out how appeals to dignity can support assisted suicide in the debate. In 2002, an English woman called Diane Pretty, she had motor neurone disease, which had left her paralyzed below the neck. She was in a wheelchair, and she had to be fed through a tube. Other people had to change her catheter bag and her incontinence pad. It was hard for her to communicate verbally beyond grunts and moans. She used pressure on a keypad on her wrist to allow her to operate an electronic voice, but longer sentences might take her 20 minutes. But her mind was still clear, and she knew that she didn't want to die by choking or suffocation, and she said that if she'd retained the ability to do so, she would have killed herself. She was asked if her life was still better than being dead, and 10 minutes later, the electronic voice said, "I am dead." She wanted a doctor to assist her suicide, something that it was illegal and still is illegal in the United Kingdom. And her palliative care specialist had watched her distress and her loss of dignity, and he hoped that she would have a peaceful and dignified death, but he couldn't guarantee it. So there I think it's fairly clear. The people, and quite a lot of people who ask for assisted suicide don't just cite pain, they also cite loss of dignity. And so dignity clearly comes in here on this side of the debate as a part of a case for allowing assisted suicide. But there are people who argue on the other side that respect for human dignity requires possibly ruling it out totally, or at least great caution about it. The American philosopher David Velleman has argued against assisted suicide. He isn't against assisted suicide in all cases, but he says that he rejects the principle that a person has a right to end his or her life if it's no longer worth living. Velleman accepts that where a person's life isn't worth living, dying may be the best thing for him or her. But quite apart, but he doesn't accept that the person's own good is the central issue. He says a person's own good only has conditional value. He says, what is good for you wouldn't matter if you didn't matter. And he says, he actually says every person does matter for his own sake because he embodies an interest-independent value. So he has a kind of two-stage approach. If somebody wants assisted suicide, you have to first find out whether they have any value. And he says, yes, everybody has a value because they embody humanity and dignity. And then he's, I suppose the question I want to ask is, why, when considering whether to let Diane Pretty die as she wants by helping her suicide, why can't we just consider what would be good for Diane Pretty, possibly bringing in other people, family members who may be involved and distressed one way or the other, possibly bringing in the implications for society of letting in. But those are all impacts on human beings. Why can't we just stop with centrally Diane Pretty and possibly some other people being brought in if they have relevant interests? But why do we have to go beyond that and ask, does Diane Pretty really matter? And this seems to me a redundant piece of thinking, but it, let me go on a bit about it. Velleman himself wants something which is a fairly moralistic test in deciding whether someone like Diane Pretty matters. He says that in discussions of assisted suicide, what I miss is the sense of a value that makes a claim on us, a value we must live up to. And he accepts that it may be, he doesn't talk particularly about the case of Diane Pretty, but I'll take her as a pretty clear case for discussing these issues. He accepts that in such a case, it may sometimes be acceptable for someone to hasten the end of his life, but he says, what I deny is that one may end one's life simply because one isn't getting enough out of it. One has to consider whether one is doing justice to it. And this is very close to what Kant says when he says that suicide to avoid suffering is wrong because it debases our humanity. Velleman says, the value of what's good for a person is only a shadow of the value inhering in a person and so cannot overshadow it. To give up one's personhood by dying in order to avoid harm denigrates the value of humanity or personhood and so is immoral. This view contrasts sharply with what I'm going to call the empathy approach. By the empathy approach, I mean that we in thinking about Diane Pretty, we should be asking ourselves not, is she doing justice to her life, but how can we help her manage the personal catastrophe that the circumstances of her life have imposed on her? That doesn't mean you never bring in any other considerations, because, for instance, if there was really good evidence that allowing assisted suicide might result in other people being pressured against their will to opt for assisted suicide, that could be a serious social harm and should be considered. But assuming that there isn't any overwhelming evidence for that, empathy says we've got to take the people who are going to be affected by a decision one way or the other and try and imagine what it's like to be them, what they feel like, what their values are, what they most want, and so on. We should do that and not consider abstract things about their duty to their own life. Kant is rather full of abstract duties. He has lots of things. He's always saying this, that, or the other mustn't be done because there's a duty to yourself. I've always been... occasionally, when I was a schoolboy, zillions of years ago, as you can see, when I was a schoolboy, sometimes I would look rather scruffy compared to the other boys. And sometimes there was one school teacher who used to say, "You're letting yourself down." And my response to that was to say, well, yes, thank you for telling me that. Actually, I forgive myself for letting myself down in this way. I'm rather unconcerned about it. Because it seems to me the whole thing about duties to yourself is a very strange... I mean, you can say you're not doing something... You know, somebody who smokes and then dies of lung cancer early, you can say, well, they acted against their own interests. But say they violated a duty to themselves, I mean, life would become an obstacle race if there are duties of that kind all over the place. Now, I want to move away from that. I'll just make one comment at the end. If I was in the position that Diane Pretty was in, and I asked for assisted suicide, and the response was to send some social worker to interview me to find out whether I was doing justice to my life, whether I was betraying my dignity, I'm afraid that what would happen is that after the 10-minute pause it took me to express something on the machine, some rather undignified obscenities might emerge from it in response to this kind of investigation. There are rather similar objections on grounds of dignity as moral status to embryo research. The central argument against embryo research of this kind is that the embryo is a human being and so has the same dignity, the same moral status as other human beings. Now, this relies on a stretched definition of human being. If somebody says, should you respect, if there's a kind of opinion poll, and somebody came up and asked you, do you believe in respecting the dignity of human beings? I guess that more or less all of you would say yes, I would probably. But that's because we tend to loosely think human beings means people. But actually, it's more plausible to think that an embryo is a potential person rather than an actual person. Now, some people deny this by saying, look, all the genes are there, so the program is set up, so the real person, the actual person rather than potential person, starts with fertilization. But if that were right, if all the genes are there, if that were right, it would mean that a caterpillar is a butterfly, because all the genes are there. For some concepts, like butterfly, there's a developmental component, and you have to reach a certain stage before you count as a butterfly. And similarly, a fertilized egg would be a chicken if all the genes are there, meant you would think. I mean, I must say one thing. I'm rather while we've been here, we've had some nice meals with Peking duck, and if we'd ordered Peking duck, and they'd brought us a nice fry up of fertilized eggs, I have to say that I would have been a little disappointed, and I might have got away with a slightly less enthusiastic view of the cuisine of Hong Kong than I actually have with the excellent, delicious, crispy Peking duck. And this contrast, this sort of approach, it's a human being. You stretch the definition of the word, of the phrase human being. Having done that, you then say human beings deserve respect, so we mustn't tamper with the embryo. But on the empathy approach, it's quite different. On the empathy approach, what we notice about an embryo is that although the bounds of consciousness in fetal development are not entirely clear, we don't think that with no nervous system developed at all, that it's remotely likely that an embryo is conscious. And so as a result, embryos don't have an inner life. They have no pain, no humiliation. And the argument that they're human beings and therefore deserve this kind of respect seems to me abstract and legalistic as against being rooted in empathy. Now, I want to move. I've been making some critical points about what I've called the legalistic or abstract approach to respect for somebody's moral standing, that version. But actually, the idea of people having moral standing that needs respect seems to me generally a good one, and I want to just start to spell out what the empathy approach to respect for people's moral standing would be like or is like. It centers on a person's life as seen from the inside, and it involves at least a plurality of values. Will doing this respect his autonomy? What does she most deeply want? What may she freely choose to shape and enlarge what she wants? What will he later be glad of? More generally, what will enrich or impoverish their lives? Now, this is a cluster of values, and they sometimes come into conflict. Autonomy sometimes conflicts, respecting letting someone choose for themselves can conflict with what actually is in their best interests. And much bioethical debate is about the extremely difficult issues raised by such cases. I'm not taking sides between utilitarians, Aristotelians, and so on. I'm saying that as well, the normal parameters of ethical debate about these sorts of issues can be included in the empathy approach. But it does involve interpreting people from the inside. And this is something which clearly is of very great importance in interpreting, for instance, the request for assisted suicide. Because if you're the medical team or the family members who may get consulted, and somebody says, I would like to be helped to kill myself, it makes all the difference in the world if this is a deep and serious thing they've thought about for a while and a stable attitude towards what they want, or whether it's a sudden whim. You know, if they say, the nurse was rude to me, the hell with that, I want assisted suicide. You don't take any notice of that other than to start investigating whether this is a signal of something deeper. So we certainly, for the empathy approach, need to do a lot of interpreting of people. And I think that often when medical ethics is taught, obviously there are general principles which are often propagated and debated, argued about, but also I think part of teaching medical ethics should be teaching techniques of interpretation. What sort of questions should you ask people? How should you communicate with them? How can we assess better than we do what their inside life is like and what they most deeply want? Now I want to move to that notice up there, it's entirely my fault. It's a cheat because it says I'm going to talk about genes as well. And I did intend to talk about genes. In fact, I wrote a great wodge of stuff about genes. But one of the things which I've noticed increasingly in the last few years as I get older is that my wife says I'm becoming a bit verbose. I'm rather surprised she thinks this. I try to talk over it so that she doesn't go on saying it. But what I found was that I'd got a lecture which would have gone on for hours and hours. And taking pity on you lot, I thought I wouldn't just go on and on, and I have to cut out something, so I've cut out the bit about genes. It's my fault. I should have let Hon know before that this is what I was going to do. But I did say, it does say something about psychiatry up there, and so I intend to try and honour that commitment anyway. I want to talk about respect for dignity as respecting someone's moral standing and how that's important in psychiatry. A very crude psychiatry, and I hope that there aren't many instances these days of such very crude psychiatry, and I believe they're very much declined, but not entirely. A very crude psychiatry may see treatment simply in terms of curing or containing a disorder and its symptoms. But the core of psychiatric respect for moral standing doesn't deny that. Of course we want, if we can, to cure the disorder or at least contain the symptoms. But it goes beyond that to seeing that the disorder and the symptoms are only aspects of a person who transcends them. Sometimes disability rights people argue, they have a slogan, I am a person, not an illness or a disorder or disability with a person attached. And this seems to me true in psychiatry as in much of the rest of medicine. So if we think that we're not dealing with a cluster of symptoms or a disorder, but a person who exhibits the disorder of the cluster of symptoms, this means that this colours how the person's spoken to, the respect with which he or she is treated. In hospital, it means, for instance, having a room which is the person's own, where he or she can't be bundled out for some administrative reason to some other room, so they feel they don't have any proper location, place of their own. It also means personal contact and friendly support. And it means, and I do know that if any of you are psychiatrists here, you'll be well aware, unless this is an almost unique country in the world, you'll be aware of underfunding, pressures to not spend more and so on. So that I'm talking about the ideal, but the fact that sometimes we can't realize the ideal doesn't mean we shouldn't try to get a picture of what the ideal is. So I want to talk about one of the key things I think might be here, continuity of care. If psychiatry was just a matter of pumping in the medication to deal with the symptoms, it wouldn't matter if you never saw the same person twice. But if it's a matter of building up skills at relating to people, building up confidence and trust, building up methods of communication, then continuity of care is really important and shouldn't be disrupted for minor improvements that might come as a result of doing so. I want to briefly give a favourable account of a particular psychiatrist. I want to quote it. There's a woman called Jay Griffiths, and she is a poet, and she also suffers from bipolar disorder or manic depression. And she wrote a book recently called Tristimania, and she appreciated the efforts, very much appreciated the efforts a particular psychiatrist had made. I'll read you just something of what she says. He made himself available, reachable. He didn't shunt me off to the circus of serial strangers, which so many psychiatric patients experience. And I was grateful for that to the bottom of my heart. It felt as if he brought his whole self to the appointments. If I'd had to see a doctor who was masked, defended, or guarded, who played a role or who wasn't truly present, it would have created a power imbalance. I would have hated In madness, anything which increases one's sense of weakness is detrimental. Now, of course, the idea of the patient as person is utterly familiar. And there are many psychiatrists and nurses who believe all this, and sometimes, despite daunting financial or institutional constraints, actually succeed in this kind of practice that Jay Griffiths describes. But I want to broaden the thing slightly by one of the great drawbacks must be of having a major psychiatric disorder must be the sense of loneliness, the feeling that people don't understand what your experience is like because they can't penetrate what's going on inside you. And it's widely known that psychiatric patients also suffer from stigma. And the stigma, I believe, is linked to the apparent impenetrability of some of the patients with psychiatric conditions. So we need to understand, I mean, it's commonplace that we need to understand psychiatric disorders better, but very often when people think about understanding psychiatric disorders better, they think, in a way, quite rightly, about understanding the neurochemical mechanisms, the genetic input, the environmental input, and so on. But I think we need two levels of understanding. We both need to understand the causal story in genetic, physical, chemical terms, but we also need to understand it, if possible, in human terms. And in this way, we have a huge advantage over people, say, 50 years ago. There is now a growing literature of first-person accounts of people talking about what it's like to have their particular disorder, giving their own life history, saying things that people said that hurt them, saying things people did to them which helped enormously, and so on. And I think we ought to try as far as possible to build up, as far as we can, a kind of approach of interpreting the inner life based on those what people have told us about what the inner life feels like from inside. I mentioned disability rights. One of the things is that disability rights campaigners have rightly moved away from the early narrow version. The early narrow version was they mustn't be discriminated against, people must be taught not to sneer or put down people, sneer at or put down people, or ridicule people who have disabilities. But increasingly, the disability rights movement has emphasized the social element in the causation of disability. There's often a medical element. You can't walk, you have to have a wheelchair. But there's also, has society designed things so that there's wheelchair access? Those kind of things, which we, I think, on the whole, are learning about pretty quickly and moving over to. But in psychiatry, the barriers to access are partly psychological. We need to remove certain mental barriers which lead to psychiatric patients seeming, as people sometimes say, weird or impenetrable. It's also true that trying to interpret psychiatric patients in human terms can sometimes be quite important actually for the treatment itself. I get to quote Jay Griffiths again. She says, "I felt at the time, and still feel now, that my doctor saved my life. So what did he do right? He listened deeply. I felt as if he let my words into his mind so that he could rehear my words right inside himself and re-listen if necessary. In a manic depressive episode, metaphors are heavy with meaning, and the metaphors must carry an almost unbearable weight," she says. "This, I think, is why people are so stubborn about repeating the precise metaphors which tell their truth. For instance, for depression, things like black sun, the black dog, a black hole, or drowning. And she makes the point that it's really important for the attentive listener to someone with a psychiatric disorder, not only to listen, but to stick with that person's own metaphor rather than substitute a different metaphor. She says, when a person's ill, a metaphor is not a decoration, rather it's a desperate attempt to send out an SOS to give the listener their coordinates because they're losing themselves. Listeners need to hear the metaphors and stay with them. My doctor used my metaphors with almost unfaltering precision, and I felt safer for it. Because he listened to my metaphors, I felt he was willing to walk with me in the landscapes of my mind. Now, as you hear me read that, you probably notice her own use of metaphor, the landscapes of my mind. One of the things about Jay Griffiths is that she is a poet, and so it's not totally surprising that for her, metaphors are particularly important. Now, I don't want to belittle what she says. I mean, I'm sure that for many other people, sticking with their metaphors is very important too. But it isn't just that one strategy. For someone whose life is a poet, no doubt metaphors are very, very central. But for someone whose life centers on being a mother or being a soldier or being a priest, there may be rather different things that matter for them. And part of this kind of good, intuitive human psychiatry would be trying to feel what matters to them. And it might not always be metaphors. Metaphors probably come up quite a bit, but other things. You know, have to think your way into what this person seems to be like, and try to work out a strategy. A final part of on this, what the aims of a more humanist psychiatry. One aim is to help the person take control of coping with the illness. This is something where I think there are going to be many, many patients who you're not going to get very far with, at least without the help of a lot of medication. But I think there's an important element which should be recognized as an important part of a humane psychiatry, which is that ideally the cure isn't just something imposed from outside. Because it's partly a matter of self-reconstruction, you need to encourage the person to try and understand and, as it were, take control themselves. I want to give you one example. There's an Australian who had called Simon Champ, who had schizophrenia. And he's given an account of how his own attitude to his own identity and its relation to the illness, schizophrenia, has changed over time. And let me just sort of briefly summarize what he says. At first, he identified with his symptoms. It was central to his identity that he had schizophrenia. And he was depressed by this, he hated it. He didn't like being a schizophrenic, but he thought it was central to him. The next stage was when he still identified with being a schizophrenic, but started to take a more positive attitude to it, and it led him to a somewhat aggressive approach to people who didn't have his disorder. He would sometimes say, "Hi, I'm Simon, I'm schizophrenic," in a kind of challenging way. Then he moved on to react against the passivity of being thought of as suffering a mental illness. And he became angry about the stigma it had and about how society had treated him. And so he started to campaign for the rights of people with disorders like his. But then he found that this campaigning gave him renewed hope for his own life. It made him feel he could do something positive. And he then started to reflect on, who am I? What is my identity? What sort of person am I? And his sense of identity had been linked to ideas about having a job and to ideas about masculinity. He had been utterly demoralized by the fact he couldn't get paid employment, and he had in various ways felt inadequate in terms of his masculinity. But then he came to see that his sense of worth could come from other things than paid work, for instance, his campaigning. And he also came to see that, as he put it, real men do sometimes cry. So he changed his views about both masculinity and jobs in terms of his identity. And he finally ends up talking about how this slow process of reclamation has been really absolutely important to his development. He says, understanding his illness has involved a deep communication with himself. He says, it's given me the most precious thread that's linked my evolving sense of self, a thread of self-reclamation, a thread of movement toward a whole and integrated sense of self, away from the early fragmentation and confusion. Then he says, you don't simply patch up the self you were before developing schizophrenia. You have to actually recreate a concept of who you are that integrates the experience of schizophrenia. He says he now has a peace of mind as I've come home to myself, a self changed, a self I last felt at 17, and yet now I'm 40. All those years separate me from the teenager I was, but somewhere inside, I'm complete again, as I used to be then. Now, of course, Simon Champ obviously has quite exceptional powers of self-analysis, self-reclamation. Psychiatrists should not feel demoralized if they can't put everybody in position to do this. But it seems to me it's a sort of ideal that ought to be there. It's an ideal which ought to hover behind as an aim, even if you can't always realize it. Now, I finished what I want to say about psychiatry. I want to just say one thing about how the theme of this lecture about interpretation links up with medical ethics as taught and practice and with a hope for this bioethics center. It's striking and obvious that collaboration in medical ethics involves both medical people and philosophers, lawyers, and others. And I want to just say that when I for 30 years, I taught ethics and philosophy in Oxford, and in talking about ethics there, I hardly ever mentioned medical matters. I'd never taught medical ethics until I moved to London to King's College. In Oxford, I used to use hypothetical examples. You know, would you divert a trolley to kill one person when it was going to kill five if you let it go on? And my Oxford students were incredibly bright. They flashed back instantly wonderful, clever, intelligent answers. When I moved to London and started to teach medical ethics, I found that, firstly, if I talked about real cases, say, some assisted suicide case, I was teaching people who were often medical professionals, doctors, nurses, psychiatrists, all sorts of people. And I would be using my imagined case. And they would say, no, it's not like that at all. No, not at all. Look, take this case we had last week. And I found I was learning hugely from them. It was quite a nice situation for me because they were paying, I was being paid, and yet I was learning more from them than they were from me. One case, I remember I produced an imaginary case, and there was a woman who's a general practitioner, quite old, older than me, though younger than me now, and she, I produced this case, and I saw her looking puzzled, so I asked her what she wanted to say. And she said, well, the first thing I would ask her is, has she told her mum? And the contrast with my Oxford students don't have mums. Oxford students come fully formed into the world, fully rational at the age of 17. When I was with these doctors, they were dealing with people who did have mums, and that kind of question was asked. I want to say this, that philosophers can seem to think about abstract principles in terms of unreal thought experiments, which don't engage with the human realities that doctors learn about through their experience of people. On the other hand, philosophers sometimes say doctors don't think deeply enough about underlying principles that shape their decisions. I think doctors do need to explore fundamental values, but the main message I want to come from this lecture is that medical ethics and philosophers need to get much more involved with better interpretation of people, their needs, values, and in general what they're like. Kant, who I have been quoting with some disapproval throughout much of this lecture, said something, talking about our knowledge of our understanding of the physical world, said that thinking without experience is empty, and experience without thinking is blind. I think that's not a bad motto for medical ethics. I wish the centre well. I know it's been going for 2 years. I'm sure it's already flourishing. But I'd like that to be one thing at the back of people's minds, that you need both thinking and experience, and preferably philosophers and doctors need to become a little bit more like each other. I'll stop there. Thank you.
We are going to have a commentator on Professor Glover's wonderful lecture, and the person who is going to comment is Professor Alistair Campbell. Professor Campbell is himself a distinguished philosopher and bioethicist, and he has been with the center, in a sense, since 2013 as an external advisor of the Center for Bioethics. So, and I don't want to waste too much time because he has a long CV, so I won't go into it. I'm sure many of you have already known Professor Campbell.
Okay. Real pleasure to be back here in CUHK and to be commenting on Jonathan's lecture. It's fortunate for me that commentators don't have to disagree because so much of what Jonathan says I feel is so timely and so important for all of us that what I'll be doing is making some suggestions maybe slightly critical at times, but in terms of developing your ideas. And the first thing I'd like to say, although, I'm not a politician, so I can say it, is I think there's no better time to say we must oppose humiliation of people. There's no better time when somehow the American people have managed to elect a person who not only humiliates people, but encourages his followers to do so. We must get back to the central core of human dignity of every human being and oppose all forms of humiliation and degradation of our fellow humans. So that's why this is such an important lecture, why my comments are merely trying to develop some of the ideas. Now, the other thing many of you are aware of is that I'm a Presbyterian, and Presbyterian sermons always have 3 points, so I've got 3 points. The first of this is, I've given the headline, it's about empathy and normative power. Now, it's often been observed that the concept of dignity, and indeed Jonathan referred to this, is right at the root of so many declarations of human rights. It really is. Dignity and human rights are really very closely allied to each other in all the international declarations. But this means that we need the concept of dignity to have some normative force, because it must enshrine not just what we'd like to happen, but what we ought to do. It must enshrine duties of some kind. And my first question to you, Jonathan, is, does empathy have this force? The force of ensuring that we do our duty in relation to our fellow human beings? And this could not be more important than at the present time, not only in Asia, but throughout the world, where there's so much threat to basic human rights. We must find a normative force for seeing our duty to respect rights. Some of you will know that another country in Asia that I work in, there was an attempt to say that human rights was just Western language that was being imposed on Asian values. Well, I'm going to quote an Asian writer now, because who's called Julia Tall. She works here in Hong Kong in the City University, because really the concept that you've been talking about, the concept that feeds into human rights, is very close to Confucian thinking. But I think we have to think in slightly different terms from empathy. We have to think particularly in terms of the notion of care or benevolence rather than empathy, and I'll come back to why I think that's necessary. So just to quote her, it's from an essay called The Paradox of Care, A Chinese Confucian Perspective on Long-Term Care. She writes, "The Confucian ethical account identifies the capacity to care and respect for others as the defining characteristics of our humanity. The giving and receiving of care are ongoing affirmations of our shared basic dignity and common humanity. Human dignity requires care, and that is why care is a moral good. Human dignity, therefore, must be the framework for guiding and constraining care." So my difficulty here is that if we talk about empathy, it's actually quite hard to achieve at times. As you put it, you want us to, and I agree with you, want us to be centered on a person's life as seen from the inside. But this is very difficult to achieve, and you've admitted that as well. So it's not strong enough as a normative force. What we can require is maybe we can't feel empathy, but we still must care for everyone, irrespective of whether we can or cannot achieve that entry into their inner lives. We may not always be able to empathize, but surely we can still care. And you won't be surprised to hear I'm quoting Kant at this time. He says, ought implies can. Well, I think we cannot sometimes empathize, but we can care, so we ought to care. It's the first point. Keep an eye on the time. I don't want to talk too long, but this lecture has entranced me. So the second one, the second point is about the end of life and what I call social solidarity. Now, you spoke very movingly of the powerful case for assisted suicide arising from tragic situations like that of Diane Pretty, and you faulted the writer Velleman for requiring that we see our lives as having value in themselves and therefore not to be given up too easily. But I think Velleman is right in saying that all of us must see there are times when a person seeking suicide can be fully understood, that we don't want to push against these terrible cases where it's so hard for that person. But my point is that that doesn't mean we should support legislating for assisted suicide. And the reasons I give, I'll put into an Asian context, because that, I think that's one of the things I'm supposed to do. The first has to do with a very strong sense of family duty, which in these societies here has a huge effect on caring for people throughout their lives. That family duty can mean that at times children feel obliged to a huge degree to provide everything as much as they can, even at great sacrifice to themselves for the parents. And in Singapore, it's actually required by law that the parent can actually sue the child for failing to support them at the end of life. Now imagine this situation. And imagine a situation now where the parent themselves sees what's happening there and feels, I'm just too much of a burden. emotionally and financially, maybe I really should let my family off the hook. And there's a law that says, well, you can get assisted suicide. So this is part of the context we have to think about. The second part of the context is not so much relevant to Hong Kong or to Singapore, but certainly to Asia and many other countries, and that is the totally inadequate health coverage in many countries and the almost virtual absence of effective terminal care. So if we push towards legislation for assisted suicide, instead of trying to fix the other things that mean that people die in desperate circumstances or suffer desperately when they need not do, we've got our priorities wrong. I got very angry with an American colleague when we were speaking in Shanghai, who was getting all these young Chinese students to say, you should really support euthanasia, had he never studied what was wrong with the Chinese healthcare system, mainland China. And there is, so why go for assisted suicide when you can't provide coverage to every single one of your own citizens? So The Economist recently carried out a survey. It's got an intriguing title. It's a survey of the quality of dying and rather than the quality of life. And they studied 80 countries to see the quality of terminal care and all the rest of it. Well, Hong Kong and Singapore came out pretty well in that survey. Singapore was 12th and Hong Kong was 22nd, but no. Maybe Vice Chancellor, we could reverse that soon. Yeah. But Indonesia was at rank 53. Mainland China was at rank 71. And the Philippines at rank 78. So if there is this inadequate care, I think we have to look at this other thing that you mentioned in your lecture, which is, what's the effect on others of our care for this person like Diane Pretty? And I think the social context is highly relevant to whether or not we should pursue legislation for assisted suicide. And my last point is your wonderful part of your lecture on psychiatry and mental illness. And here I think you are your most powerful and effective, if I may say so, in terms of the empathy link that we just need to try to find here in the case of mental illness. It's no accident that one of the old terms for psychiatrist was alienist. Alienist because these people seem so alien from us, as though they're different, they're not human in any way. And again, to briefly mention the Asian context, there are issues here, particularly with loss of face for the family when there's mental illness. And certainly in some areas, there's a tendency to deny the mental illness of the family member and to offer covert medication, not facing up to the facts of the mental illness. So surely, Jonathan, I would agree that your plea for empathy and an imaginative entry into this alien world is absolutely right. And if I could suggest some more reading for you, we always do this to each other, don't we? Hannah Green, maybe you've read it, I Never Promised You a Rose Garden. It's a fantastic book, like the ones you are quoting, talking of how a genuine psychiatric care can make such a difference to a person with very, very serious psychiatric illness. But the other one you certainly do know is One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. But if you haven't read the book, you'll have seen the film, and many of you young people may have seen the film with Jack Nicholson. Now, the thing is this, is it actually possible to get the kind of care that you believe we should have for the psychiatrically ill? You already referred to underfunding. Psychiatry is desperately underfunded. If we have a duty to care for these people, why do we go for the quick and easy solution? Why do we go for the chemical restraints? We don't provide the kind of personal care and continuity of care you talked about. So next time you give a lecture, I'd like you to be even tougher on this. And I would like you to tell people in governments you're not doing your duty in relation to human dignity, and especially in relation to this huge number of people in our countries that suffer from psychiatric illness. So my final message to you, Jonathan, is congratulations on a wonderful lecture, but get tougher. Thank you.
Thank you very much to Professor Jonathan Glover's inspiring talk. I have two related questions. The first one is, I wonder what you would comment if I say, I respect your dignity, and I respect you as a person. Okay. I ask this first question because some philosophers try to point out that the idea of dignity may be redundant. Well, this is my first question. Okay. My second question is that in the very interesting talk, you mentioned Kant's moral autonomy or rational autonomy. I want to ask the question, why should we respect rational autonomy? Is this the ultimate answer, or is there anything further to support rational autonomy so that we need to respect it? I guess if we press Kant, he would point to something supernatural, our supernatural will to overcome our empirical inclinations and desires. But I guess this is not the approach you may accept. So I wonder, what is the justification for respecting rational autonomy? I say this question is related to the first one because for those philosophers who think that dignity may be redundant, but we still use it, probably because of some religious leftover, because life is sacred, and therefore we need to respect people. So I guess the two questions are related. Thank you.
Well, first, I think that some uses of the phrase respect for dignity, really we can easily substitute something else, not using that word. So that I doubt if many people would disagree that we should avoid humiliating people. But we don't have to say we should avoid humiliating people because of dignity. We can, if we want, just say humiliation is bad, and that's what we cash out that expression with respect for dignity as. On the other hand, I think that it's quite a good idea to have some idea of the second version of respect for dignity, the idea of moral standing. And I'd just like to give one example, and I must apologize to anyone who came the other day to a talk I gave at the Asia Society, because I used this in answering a question there. In the old apartheid racist South Africa, Archbishop Tutu, when he was a child, about seven, I think, he was with his mother, a black woman who was cleaning the floor. And he was used to, and she was used to, the fact that white people would ignore her as though she wasn't there. They'd walk past her, they wouldn't show any interest. She'd get out of their way, they wouldn't tip anything. And Trevor Huddleston, an Anglican priest who campaigned against the racist arrangements then, he walked through the room as a youngish man, and he saw Tutu's mother, and he had on some elaborate ecclesiastical headgear, and he took it off, doffed his cap, and indicated recognition of her and respect. And Tutu, as a child, later on, he wrote an obituary, 18 years later, he wrote an obituary of Trevor Huddleston. And he said, I was astonished when this happened, that a white man should notice my mother and show this sign of respect. And he said that the fact that this happened made him have a different attitude as he grew up to white people who generally were systematically oppressing black people like him. Now, I know how we can find some other word that doesn't actually use dignity or understanding. But in a way, what it seems to me Per Adelson was doing was signaling his respect for her moral standing. And he, in his book, Per Adelson wrote a book called Not For Your Comfort, and he said, for him, the racism of that period was a kind of moral blasphemy, because he said he believed that every human being is made in the image of God, and so to deny recognition and respect to any human being is to do it to God, and that's a kind of blasphemy. Now, I, as a non-religious person, don't go along with the reason, but I go along very much with the importance of that kind of respect. And we don't have to use the word dignity, we can say respect for moral standing. But it's signaling that you have the same moral standing that I do. I'm white, you're black, I'm a man, you're a woman. But none of that is relevant, because we all deserve that kind of respect. I don't want to fight you over the word if you want to get rid of it, but the substance, I think, is something of real importance. Can I just go to the other question you asked? I'm sorry to be so brief, but having myself somewhat run over time, why respect rational autonomy? Well, firstly, that's Kant's idea, we ought to be respecting rational autonomy. I don't so much care about the rational bit, because I think there are all sorts of, for instance, people with severe learning difficulties who may have considerable difficulty in putting together reasons for behaving in a certain way, but nonetheless, their decisions about their own lives should, within certain constraints, not harming other people, not bringing on disasters they don't understand on themselves, but there's room for considerable respect for their own autonomy, even though we know that it's a limited and less rational.
First of all, I must say I thoroughly enjoy your lecture. But I have a problem with the definition of dignity, because we all have, I think dignity is something that is very difficult to set a benchmark on. Different people have different standard or different concepts of dignity. And sometimes it may, well, it obviously varies from culture to culture, and it also varies from person to person. And when a patient is in serious illness, he may go into depression, and he thinks something which is very distressing for him or her, that hurts his dignity, may not in, well, when he is out of the depression, may not be actually so serious about it. So, I actually come across, in fact, Hong Kong has a very famous history of a person who was a 20-odd-year-old young man graduate from university and hurt and injured his spinal cord and became tetraplegic. And he ended up lying in hospital bed for 17 years. And he wrote a book about asking for assisted suicide or euthanasia, because he said even when a cockroach walked across his face, he could not get rid of the cockroach. He thought he was a total disgrace and a total waste of human resources. So after staying in hospital authority for 17 years, he requested to the chief executive of Hong Kong to pass the law of euthanasia to end his miserable life. And I come across this person, and I thought he was actually in some degree of depression, which obviously is because of his chronic illness. And I cut the long story short. Then we tried to help him get out of his misery, make himself to feel that he is still worthwhile to live and so on. And then he become a totally different person. So my question for you is, in such a fluctuating level of feeling being respect or not, especially in someone who has a chronic illness, who are we to decide or make any important decision for this person about whether or not we should allow him to prolong his suffering? I may not phrase my question very clearly, but I really feel that there are many gray areas and many difficult situations that as a third person, it is very hard for us to make any judgment or decision in such circumstances.
I'm sure you're right that there are huge numbers of gray areas, and this sounds a very powerful instance. So, when you say, who are we to make any sort of decision for this person? In one way, we can't avoid making some sort of decision, because we either have to support his request to end his life, or we have to not use it. So we are bound to take a decision one way or another. I was interested there that you said, it seemed to be absolutely right what you said, that you tried to talk him out of his depressive attitude. But it seems to be the first thing I would want to say is, yes, some kind of psychotherapy to explore whether this is a really deep commitment of his or whether it could change and so on. Even if we've got him saying still, yes, I still feel this way, it really is something I feel, you may then ask, is he competent to decide, or is his rationality being distorted by the case of the case of depression? And it's notorious that we across the world find it incredibly difficult to decide that, because the standard tests for psychiatric competence, the MacArthur tests and so on, they tend to talk about the ability to take a decision, the ability to express it, the ability to understand relevant facts, and then the ability to make a judgment. But it isn't quite clear whether all you need to understand is the information of a scientific or medical kind, or whether you need to understand the implications of deciding you're going to die emotionally. Because one thing for people in psychiatric conditions often do is they have a certain lightness. You know, they say, oh, I don't care about dying. You say, but look, this is terrible, you know. Oh, I don't mind, I'll die, yes. And in a way that doesn't make it seem as though they really have an emotional appreciation as against a purely intellectual appreciation. I wish I had the answer to your question, because that would require me to have a better version of the test for psychiatric competence to decide. And I'm not sure I have that, but it's a really difficult question to throw at me.
Thank you very much, Professor Glover, for your lecture. And I also want to thank Professor Campbell for your illuminating remarks. I have a question about the lecture's mentioning of David Velleman's article, probably some years ago, titled A Right to Offer Self-Termination. And it seems to me that you don't agree with Velleman's approach, and you favor instead of a certain kind of empathy approach. But I have to say that I find Velleman's approach very appealing, although by some gut feeling, I'm more on the side of people like Ronald Dworkin's argument in his Life Dominion. But let me put my question up front. Do you think Velleman is wrong? Can we, on the one hand, think that Velleman is pretty right about saying things like, if your life doesn't matter, then your choice doesn't matter too. It seems to me to be very appealing and convincing. Can we say that this approach has a point, and your empathy approach also has a point, and the two approaches are in tension, or should we choose either one, or can we say both have points?
So, is my question?
Jonathan has asked me to respond, but I think he should as well. But I think I think it's important
you did say it, but quite quickly, to say that Velleman is not saying he's always against suicide.
Yeah, sure.
So it's not a very rigid opposition. It's just putting another calculation in, as it were, another counter into the argument, which is, what can give, what do you owe to your life, because it is a life that deserves to be respected. If you feel as clearly Diane Britty did, actually there is no life anymore, why should I owe anything? I think it's entirely understandable. I'll be very quick, but I remember very, very clearly a case I was involved in when I was a professor of biomedical ethics in New Zealand. And I use her example often in books that I write, where she was tetraplegic and after many, many years of struggling could not come to terms with it. But she fought it through very hard, and she realized her obligations to her family and her children who were quite young. But eventually she said, no, it's no longer me. I can't be me anymore, so I'm like the quote you used of someone else. And what happened in that case was she was on a respirator, they actually fitted a switch that she could turn up herself. So it was assisted suicide, sure, but it wasn't giving her a lethal drug. So let's see what John has to say. I'm sympathetic, but I think we have to be cautious all of that.
Here's where I believe, whether Alistair may correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe this is a case of genuine disagreement between us, because Alistair, I think, said just then that he thinks we should ask what we owe to our lives, whereas I think that's complete rubbish. Alistair and I know each other. I know each other very well. I'm not hearing you to Alistair. We talk to each other all the time, right?
Jonathan, I'm not walking out because of what you said. I'm walking out because we have to go now. I'm going to miss the plane. So, honestly, that's it.
That's great. So, leaving the field today, I can see even worse things. Good to see you. Richard, thank you before. I've never understood why this abstract thing called my life has any claim on me. If there are all sorts of things I care about, so that yes, I mean, I might, for instance, there are, for instance, some cases of people who die in embarrassing circumstances. I mean, there have been several cases in Britain. There's one politician, I remember, who suffocated in the process of going through some very unusual sexually stimulating thing that excited him. And I think that if I were the sort of person who enjoyed that sort of activity, thought there was a real risk of dying in it, I might feel, well, you know, I've got the story I tell about my life, and I don't want the story everybody else tells about it to be one that it leads up to a death like that. So that's because I care about it. It's not because there's a thing called my life that I feel I owe anything to.
Maybe just one follow-up. I guess other people certainly have some good questions. So do you think you endorse some sort of self-ownership with regard to these problems? So I own my life or what? Because I find Velleman's main argument convincing, because his point, as we have said, why my life really matter, why my suffering or happiness matter if my life isn't objectively important. So I guess you understand what I'm going to say, so objective values instead of talking about...
It has all sorts of assumptions that there are objective values that, in terms of which we can assess whether a person matters.
I don't know about that. I'm always puzzled about objective values. I you'll know there's a debate which may go on forever about that. I just think that it's... And I dislike the idea that in order to decide to end my life, I have to submit to the judgment of somebody else about whether I am carrying out my duty to my life. I find the phrase duty to my life obscure. I can understand duties to people, because people have standing, as Kant says, whereas abstractions, in my opinion, don't.
I'd like to raise a more practical question about medical education, since you are in that sweet spot with the tremendous history and moral philosophy and an experience with medics and medical students. So our medical students here will need to respect the dignity of their patients. In part, empathy, even if it doesn't have normative force, is going to give access and insight into that. And yet in medicine, empathy needs to be managed and controlled also. One needs a sense of emotional distance as well as emotional engagement and empathy with the patient. And I wonder if you'd like to talk a little bit about that or whether you've addressed that with your students in their training.
It's a very complicated cluster of issues, isn't it? Because, I've heard many doctors say, and I believe them, that many doctors say you mustn't get too engaged with your patient. This can distort your judgment in various ways. You aren't helping them most. You know, if I'm lying in bed and the doctor comes in with tears in her eyes and says, "Oh, this is so," I think it's really making me so sad. I do feel for you. That actually doesn't help me nearly as much as the briskly official doctor who does something else. And I agree that the point that Alistair made, that we don't always have empathy for people, and yet we can still... what I meant to say, I had to, because I was trying not to overrun more than I did, what I actually call the phrase in my written paper is empathy linked. In other words, it's not that we have to always feel empathy, it's that we have to know that this is a person for whom empathy is appropriate, and even if we can't manage it, we've still got to show them the concern and care that is appropriate, because you know, I may have a prejudice, I mean, against somebody. Maybe if I was a doctor and some person came in and kept telling me that he was a convinced member of the Ku Klux Klan and hated black people and all the rest of it, and I might find I had huge difficulty in getting empathy from this person, even if this person was suffering. But as a rational person, I can detach myself from my lack of empathy and say this is somebody who, whether I like the opinions or not, this person deserves to be treated as someone who has an inner life that needs to be, as far as possible, understood and respected.
I see that you place empathy in very high position. I concur with that. I see that you have placed a very high position on empathy, but it seems to me your empathy towards the embryo is not very high. I see that embryo also breathe oxygen through the umbilical cord, and they also, or fetus, a future of the embryo, they may also blink or kick or moves like you, and I want to ask what's your view on partial birth abortion?
It's true that I don't have empathy for embryos at all, because I don't think they have an inner life. Now, I understand your point that an embryo left and treated well and will normally, if things go well, will become a person who does have an empathy. But I don't feel that a potential person like that has a strong claim. Because if one asks, somebody who says embryos have claims on us because of the future person they will become. And so you mustn't obstruct the process of them becoming that. That would also be an argument against contraceptives, and indeed it would also be an argument against chastity. If I practice chastity or use contraception, I am blocking the routes to a person who might otherwise have come into being. And it doesn't seem to me that the mere fact that the genes are mixed together is enough to show that the person has a claim on me, the potential person.
Thank you. I would want to actually ask about that. You know, like the lecture is mostly for medical students, but I would also want to ask a question, not from this kind of perspective, but that as a student with, for example, a mental illness, because of this chronic in a university or an institution like this, you know, students that are related with medical majors or psychology, psychiatrists, they can receive like knowledge and certain these ethic discussions. But however, for other majors, if they actually don't know much of it, how may those like students and other those who suffered from that actually learn more about that? Because when you talk about dignity and respect, often when you once tell your friends that you have this certain of illness, actually the fact that even though they on the outside surface, it's like, I respect them, they say that, oh, I understand. But actually in return, when they start talking back to you or act to you, you could feel that what they say about I understand isn't really understanding, because they would act in a way that is disrespecting or humiliating you, or as a way they would ask you, why can't you just, for example, if you suffer from depression, they would just make this simply a question of, why can't you just be happy? And how do you think that ethically that people in other majors as well, you know, can be educated about all these bioethical issues?
Partly there's a general problem about if you're in any one faculty, you won't be learning a whole lot of stuff in any in many other faculties. But I think that all the same, there could be, and I favor vigorous campaigning. I mean, I said earlier, I was hugely welcoming of the literature people have describing what it's like. I don't know if you know, or any of the other people in the audience know, there's a book by Kay Redfield Jameson called An Unquiet Mind. And she is a distinguished psychologist who specializes in psychiatric disorders. She's at Johns Hopkins University in the United States. And she's the co-author of a magnificent textbook on manic depression. And later she published an autobiography in which it turns out that the quotes from patients in the textbook were in fact written by her about her own experience. And she describes how, not just among people who aren't psychiatrists, but as a practicing psychologist working with psychiatrists, they showed little sympathy or empathy with her having this disorder and tended to treat it as a kind of failing. So I think the more people read that kind of book and see what it's like from the inside, the better. Of course, I know that not all that many people read huge numbers of books outside their field. They tend to be looking at these on the internet anyway. But, I mean, there's no simple answer. We need, as a society, as a world society, whether in Hong Kong or the United Kingdom or wherever, we need to confront these issues more and talk about stigma. And I was arguing that part of dissolving stigma is for professionals to work on making available some more intuitive kind of understanding of what the experiences of people are like. And we can build on first-person accounts like Gay Jameson's. I can't immediately say that, you know, if you're studying history and they're studying psychiatry, that they will sympathize with you if you have a disorder. And it's going to take a long time. It's a long, slow business. But I hope we can, most of us, take heart from the way in which attitudes towards gay people have changed over, in many countries of the world, over the last 50 years or so. When I was young, and see how old I am for my white hair, when I was young, ages ago, at least in Britain, male homosexuality was illegal. People who talked about it tended to talk about it as either a wicked sin or alternatively as a disease. It was only in the 1970s that the DSM, the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders in the United States, it was only in, I think, 1973 or 4, that being gay stopped being treated as a personality disorder. But in that time, there have been huge advances. Of course, there are still horrible attacks sometimes on gay people. Sometimes they suffer insults and discrimination. But there's been a huge change. And I think that could be taken as the model for what we ought to try to do about psychiatry.
As a follow-up question, I would actually also like to ask about like the professors from the university, because for example, I'm a student majoring in English literature and everything, so, but I personally, actually because of academic stress, I suffer from anxiety and depression. I would also ask, like, for practical ethics, when you talk about practical, I was happy because it's not hypothesis, but I would like to ask, would there actually be any policies or help or care that there or framework that is trying to implement in the university as an institution to put these practical ethics into one of the running systems? Thank you so much.
No, I'm not a policymaker. I just work for the general education in the university. I'm the director of the general education office. And in fact, in our general education program, we do have some courses in bioethics offered by the philosophy department. And we have also some courses on mental health, like that, offered by the social work department. So these are existing courses we offered. And I think we welcome some other courses on bioethics in the general education program. So students who feel the needs, who want to know more, can take this course. Yeah, they are existing.
Could I ask you have a counseling service for students?
Counseling services, yeah, of course. It's run by our Office of Student Affairs. Yeah, we do have. Yeah.
The counseling service can refer them on for medical help if necessary.
This I'm not sure. and then we have college system. In fact, in our college system, we do have some counselors too. Yeah.
Hi. Thank you so much for your lecture. Recently, I read a book called "When Breath Becomes Air" by Paul Kalanithi, a young medical resident in the US who was diagnosed with lung cancer in his sixth year of residency. And he used the remaining part of his life to write about that, what it was like to experience his own mortality. My question is, do you think empathy can be taught, especially to medical students?
I guess some medical students will be slightly prickling at the "can it be taught especially to medical students?" I don't suppose you meant they're particularly resistant to breath thinking. Can empathy be taught? To a degree, I believe, yes. I spent a lot of time a few years ago interviewing people in a psychiatric hospital for people who'd committed major violent crimes and had the diagnosis of antisocial personality disorder, which is a kind of embracing category, which at the extreme includes psychopaths. This also includes many people much milder. And what people often say about those people is that they lack empathy and lack a conscience. Leave aside the conscience for the moment, but the empathy I spent a lot of time interviewing them, asking them about, I didn't ask them about what their crime was, they often they wanted to tell me anyway, but I would say, when you committed your crime, did you feel, have any feelings for how the victim might feel? And often they said no, but when they explored it, they often talked about having had absolutely horrendous childhoods. And of course that could be just an excuse, but actually the psychiatrists in the hospital said something like 90% of the people they had at that prison-like hospital, that criminal hospital, something like 90% had horrendous childhoods. The ones I interviewed often talked about sexual abuse, not being loved, being rejected, being humiliated in childhood. And as a result, one of them said to me, I said, did you have empathy? I didn't use the word empathy, but did you feel how the person might feel? And he said, no. And so I said, well, could you have felt like that? And he said, well, I probably could, but I had such a hell of a life that I brought down drinkers. I deliberately shut off because people hadn't been good to me. Why the hell should I be good to anyone else? And there was quite a lot of variation, and they were not all the interviews were the same. But I think a huge amount comes from how people are treated in childhood. Now, there's no easy way in which the medical profession or the state can reorganize how people are treated in childhood. But my belief is that often things are improving. I mean, I can remember being in schools when I was young. I wasn't badly treated particularly, but the schools, they caned people and they had a very harsh approach in many ways, which would be, I think, unthinkable now. So slowly over time, there's some hope of that kind of thing evolving. The other thing is that one of the things I was struck by was that the people I interviewed didn't have respect for other people's interests or rights or claims. And again, it seems to me that having respect is something you learn by being respected yourself. And my belief is that while some parents are wildly responsible and don't care what happens to their children, the great majority of parents want to do well by their children. And if we publicize enough that children need to be respected, need to be talked to in a way that treats them fundamentally as equals, that they're shown sympathy when they're hurt, they're not rejected. Now, all of us know, anyone who's been a parent knows that we don't live up to it. I mean, we all try. There's this rather nice thing the British psychoanalyst Winnicott produced, the phrase, a good enough parent. And anyone who's been a parent is probably pretty pleased to hear that there is such a phrase, good enough parent, because we all, most of us, don't succeed in being perfect. But I think there's at least a chance that people try to be a good enough parent, and if the culture slowly changes by education to show people that these emotional things are important. It isn't just, will your child get a good job and get good grades in school in order to get there, get on to the next stage. That hugely central to good parenting is emotional sympathy and love.
Well, thank you very much. And before I thank you for coming here to ask you, over here.
And I'm sorry I ran over a bit. My wife was tapping at her watch while I was doing it, but I decided I'd take the risk of boring you all for another 5 minutes or so. Thank you for your questions. I'm sorry I haven't had perfect answers for them all, but I'm really enjoying my trip here, and I've enjoyed this meeting hugely. Thank you so much.